All right, beginning in verse 1, we're going to read the scriptures, we're going to pray, and then let's see what the Lord does. Verse 1, after he had finished all his sayings in the hearing of the people, he entered Capernaum. Now a centurion had a servant who was sick, and he was at the point of death, and he was highly valued by him. And when the centurion heard about Jesus, he sent to him elders of the Jews, asking him to come and heal his servant. And when they came to Jesus, they pleaded with him earnestly, saying, He's worthy to have you do this for him. For he loves our nation, and he is the one who built us our synagogue. Verse 6, and Jesus went with them, and when he was not far from the house, the centurion sent friends, saying to him, Lord, do not trouble yourself, for I am not worthy to have you come under my roof. Therefore, I did not presume to come to you, but say the word, and let my servant be healed. For I, too, am a man set under authority, with soldiers under me. And I say to one, go, and he goes. And to another, I say, come, and he comes. And to my servant, do this, and he does it. And when Jesus heard these things, he marveled at him. And turning to the crowd that followed him, said, I tell you, not even in Israel have I found such faith. And when those who had been sent returned to the house, they found the servant well. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, Lord, we want to be a church that's known for our faith, Lord. We want to be a church that is willing to step out into the unseen in order that you might reign and that you might do wonderful, wonderful things, not only in our lives, but in the lives of our community, in the lives of our friends, in the lives of our family, in the lives of our workplaces. And Lord Jesus, we can only do that, Father, Lord, if you give us faith. Lord Jesus, we know as Scripture proclaims, Lord, even when we were faithless, Lord, you remained faithful because you cannot deny yourself. Your faithfulness to us, your steadfast love to us is part of your inherent character. And Lord Jesus, if we are being made and conformed to the image of the Son, Jesus Christ, Lord, that should be part of our character too. Help us, Lord Jesus. We are so weak. We are so distracted by the affectations of this world, the flesh and the devil. Lord, we lack faith because of fear. Lord, help us. Help us, Lord Jesus. You are the great creative God. Lord, all of creation that we get to enjoy, all of the abundance that is part of the good things of this creation comes from you as creative God. But Lord, we need you to create in us clean hearts tonight. Lord, renew right spirits within us, Lord. That the joy of the Lord might be our true satisfaction. So help us, speak to us. Holy Spirit, fill us as we receive your word. Lord, fill me as I preach your word. Lord Jesus, we come with only empty hands, Lord, but confident and with full of faith that you're going to fill them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. So a few weeks ago, I don't even know now. It just seems like a blur. So I'm just going to say a few weeks. We finished our four-week series on Jesus' Sermon on the Plain. You guys remember that? I hope so. Hope it hasn't been too long. Jesus' Sermon on the Plain, which is very similar to his Sermon on the Mount. And then we had some great teachings from Pastor Steve Brookshire while I was away, while a lot of the pastoral staff was away in Israel leading a tour. And now we're back to continuing the Gospel of Luke. Just as a reminder, where are we at? What's happening? How is the narrative progressing? Well, what's happening right now is Jesus is continuing really the exercising of his dominion over all that evil and sin seeks to have dominion on this earth. And he's doing this by walking a perfect and sinless life and proclaiming through miracles and signs that he's just not a prophet, he's not just a rabbi, he's not just a wise man, he's not a guru, he's not a mystic, but he is in fact God incarnate. He is in fact God put on flesh to come to earth, to condescend to us, to do a certain work, a purposeful work. by bringing redemption to people that cannot bring redemption on our own. His authority now, as he's doing these miracles, as he's ministering, as he's preaching in the synagogues, his authority is expanding, not just out of Capernaum, not just out of Judea, but all over the nation of Israel, even into Jerusalem, even into the ears of these religious leaders who are coming up north to hear about this special, special man. And this uniqueness of his ministry, it's not just his powerful, authoritative teaching. The uniqueness of his ministry that is so segregating and so powerful, it's not just through his healing and through his miracles. It's not through the exorcisms or the removal of demons from demon-possessed people. What is causing such a stir is there's a man in Israel that actually claims to have the authority to forgive people of their sins. No other man has claimed that authority and has been able to prove that he is able to do that. And this is what makes people, when they encounter Jesus, and even today, this is the same today as it even was 2,000 years ago in Israel, it makes people question who really is this Jesus. They question his identity. And it's this that makes it necessary for those who then encounter Christ to then respond to these grand statements that he's making. He makes some pretty grand statements. When he's reading the prophet Isaiah and it's speaking of the coming Messiah, and he tells the synagogue in Nazareth, hey guys, guess what? This is being fulfilled before your very eyes because this I am who Isaiah talked about. It's a pretty grand statement, right? For him to be able to proclaim in the Gospels, I am the only way, I'm the only truth, I'm the only life. No man can come to God himself but through me. That's a pretty grand statement. And for him to be able to make these claims, there must be a response to the people that hear these words. They must make a decision when they encounter Christ. There's no way for any man to hear the claims of the gospel to remain neutral concerning who Jesus is. And so this becomes almost kind of like, in a way, a story problem. Do you guys remember story problems in math at school? I hated story problems. They were the bane of my existence. If there is a math test and half of them are story problems, you might as well give me an F because I just can't figure out why a train would want to leave New York to Chicago for 500 miles an hour, whatever that is. But this story problem has an eternal weight. It has an eternal consequence. Is he the Messiah? Is he really who he claims to be? Or even if he's not, like, how does this work even logically? Can a lunatic speak so clearly and effectively as we've heard in his Sermon on the Plain? Or can a liar heal? Can a liar do these miracles? Why would sovereign God allow someone who is a deceiver to be able to do these wonderful works? It's this almost this paradox, unless the evidence actually points that he is who he says he is. How can a person respond to these grand statements? It takes faith. It takes faith. And this is really going to be the central idea, the central topic that we're going to be looking at now, really from Luke chapter 7 all through chapter 8. Because what we're going to encounter in these two chapters is our people questioning the identity of Jesus and automatically coming to a crisis of faith, a crossroads of faith, that in making a decision, they will cross a threshold that they know that they cannot or will not return anymore. Now, we ask this question, how do we define faith? How do we know what faith is? Well, we know from Scripture, Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. Many of these are memorizing verses that we've heard before. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for. It's the conviction of things not seen. It goes beyond natural scientific logic and reasoning. It's not natural, but it is the belief in supernatural. And so faith, therefore, must be the central theme for the next chapters of 7 and 8, because, friends, faith is the foundation upon which our Christianity rests upon. It's by faith we believe Jesus Christ is the Messiah. It is by faith we believe that His blood actually cleanses us from all sin. And it's by faith we believe we have an eternal hope and an eternal glory that we get to receive into the future. So back to the narrative. After Jesus, you know, He's returned from preaching on the path of His kingdom people on earth. That was all about the Sermon on the Plain. How do kingdom citizens of Christ under His kingdom, under His throne, how are we to act and how are we to live? And so he represented that to us, and He made evidence to that, and He preached us with such great wisdom in chapter 6. And now, in engaging with Jesus in this narrative, people are going to start questioning, okay, Lord, put to action the preaching wisdom that You showed us in chapter 6. What we're going to see here is the healing in chapter 7 of verse 1 through 10. We're going to see the healing of a servant. Now, many of us can kind of wonder, well, you know what? We've seen Jesus heal before. We've read these narratives before. Why do we need to hear another healing story? With the right perspective, though, I want to kind of change our focus. Because really, this story isn't necessarily about Jesus healing another man on his deathbed. But rather, what we are looking at is a character study of a man who has faith in another person that he has never met before. This is a character study on faith, where a man will choose to put faith in another even when he is uncertain, even when he does not have 100% evidence about this man's identity. So let's just dive right in verses 1 and 2 together. After he had finished his sayings in the hearing of the people, he entered Capernaum. And now a centurion had a servant, and he was sick, and he was at the point of death, who was highly valued by him, by this centurion. So let's set the stage. Luke is setting the stage here. Finished his sayings. That's speaking about Jesus finishing that sermon on the plain. And this shows us that Jesus often and probably taught that same message more than once, because we have two accounts in the Gospels of Jesus preaching the same message, but we have two different locations where he preached. One was at a mount, so it's the Sermon on the Mount, and then we have here on the plain as he stepped down from the mountain after choosing his 12 apostles. And so there's two actions and there's two groups of people. There's Jesus preaching, and then also in verse 1 it says, in the hearing of the people. What does that say to us? It means that people walked away from the teaching having been changed. They were changed in hearing this wisdom and really this reality-destroying, this reality-destroying work of promises to Jesus, from Jesus, where he talks about, you know what, if you're poor, you have great blessing. That's reality-shattering. If you're hungry, you actually have great blessing because yours is the kingdom of God. If you're weeping, if you're sorrowful, you're actually blessed because the Lord promises laughter in your life. Do you have people that hate you, that exclude you, that reject you, that have betrayed you? Well, blessed are you if you've received these things on account of me, because all of that is evidence that points that you are my children. And you have so much of a greater inheritance than any of the temporary sufferings of this world. Reality shattering. And so these people walked away with something. And I'm not just talking about a small smattering of people. It's in the potential of thousands of followers of Jesus outside of Capernaum, hearing him preach these words. And as he's getting done, he walks back into town and he's followed by these throngs and throngs of people. Think about the apostles who were chosen beforehand, where their first ministry was to serve and learn alongside Jesus as citizens under the king. And after all this preaching, I can imagine they follow Jesus back into town, and there he meets an emissary of a man who is totally opposite to the people's idea of who needs a Jesus Messiah. They meet an emissary from a Gentile, Roman, military, political leader. Completely opposite to those that are poor in spirit, those that are hungry, those that are excluded, rejected, and betrayed. So how is Jesus going to react? All of a sudden, there's action that's needed from these words. What is Jesus going to do? I mean, could you be a person in that crowd for a moment? I'm just going to follow Jesus wherever he goes because of his ministry and what he's doing. I mean, there's no man that I've ever encountered before like this man. And we're going back into Capernaum where he does all of his ministry. But then all of a sudden, wait a minute, Jesus. Why are you talking to these guys? Didn't you just preach, blessed are the poor in spirit? This man is wealthy. Did you just preach woe to those who are rich, for they found their consolation? Well, guess who's the richest guy in town? This guy. They waited on Jesus to see if he would practice what he preached, for this man, this Roman centurion, symbolized the Roman tyrannical occupation of the people. Even if he was diplomatic to them, as we can see in the future. And the grand question comes all the way back to the Sermon on the Plain. Is Jesus going to love our enemy? Is he going to love our enemy? Let's see more about this military officer. Verse 2, it says he's a centurion. This centurion is a title, it's a military title, meaning that he was a principal officer in the Roman army, which means he was responsible for the command of 100 men, 100 soldiers, and therefore then he was one of 60 centurions that would compose a Roman legion of 6,000 men, okay? He was one of 60 men over 6,000 men. They were men of wealth within their communities because of their leadership. And in turn, they had the capability of diplomacy, doing charitable works, helping with the community, because Roman diplomacy saw for the potential of promotion, you didn't want to stay a centurion for the rest of your life. You wanted to move up into a higher military position. And so you did things within your community that was successful, that brought happiness, fulfillment to this community. So one being a voice of public charity and support. Hence, we see how he was supportive of the Jewish community. And we even see that these men say that he's worthy because he helped build the synagogue within Capernaum. As a side tangent, just a few weeks ago, in our tour to Israel, you can actually see the foundation of where the synagogue was built in Capernaum. And you can actually walk on the stones of the flooring of this synagogue where Jesus was in Capernaum that was built by this centurion. It's a wonderful, powerful thing. But back to this man. If you're a poor person, if you're a man of common means in Capernaum, when you see this guy walking by, what kind of assumptions would you make? There he is, wealthy. He's ambitious. He's authoritative, he's strategic, he has no reason to have any relationship with me, and he symbolizes the control over my people. Now contrast that to this servant here in verse 2. This servant who was sick at the point of death, who was highly valued by him. If you think about Roman Jewish culture at this time, no two people were more socially contrasted than this partnership and this relationship. A centurion, in comparison, all the way to the under end of the spectrum, a slave. A Roman citizen who had a servant who was sick, as this centurion had a servant that was sick. Under Roman law, had every right to take the servant out of his house and actually kill him as a means of just any other day, as if you had a horse that broke its leg and could no longer pull a wagon anymore. Simply take out your servant outside and kill your servant because he really wasn't a man after all. He was simply another animal of labor for you. So when we see in verse 2 that this servant was highly valued, that says something about this centurion. This great change in the relationship, though, is based on this centurion's view of the slave. He's highly valued. Highly valued. In the literal Greek, what this means is that the centurion valued this servant as if he was his own son. Who does that? In those culture, in that context, that's not natural. That's not natural reality. Who does that as a centurion? Who loves a slave as if he were his own son? I mean, to the crowd, who would they say that they are most in tune with? They would say the servant. I have no relationship with the centurion. However, even this characteristic of the centurion, you know who it points to? It doesn't point to the people. The love, the highly valued compassion that the centurion has for the servant, that's not a crowd moral ethic. What that shows is something bigger. It shows that it's a characteristic and a perspective of God who loves us as servants, even as his own children. We who do not deserve to even live in the house of a centurion, God bids us come live in my house. Take part of my riches. Take and eat of my food. Have your share of my inheritance. I am adopting you as my own child. And this is why it's so paradoxical. You hear in these Psalms about the servant crying out to God, as David and many other the psalmists say. For instance, Psalm 119, verse 24, he says, Deal with your servant according to your steadfast love. Teach me your statutes. No one loves their servants. No one had to love their servants. That was a revolutionary act, a beyond reality notion. It was a supernatural occurrence. And so already we hear something about the centurion, that God is working in the heart and life of this man to prepare him for an encounter with Jesus that's going to change his life forever. So let's get back to it, verse 3 to 5. Excuse me. When the centurion heard about Jesus, he sent to him elders of the Jews, asking him to come and heal his servant. And when they came to Jesus, they pleaded with him earnestly, saying, he's worthy to have you do this for him, for he loves our nation, and he is the one who built us our synagogue. You know, this man is diplomatic, and so in a place of authority, from one man of authority to another man of authority, you just wouldn't go knock on somebody's door. You would send emissaries. You would send other servants. And the higher authority of those servants showed how powerful and authoritative you were in saying, hey, check out these messengers. And so, in a way, he's sending These men who are Jewish elders, possibly even rabbinical teachers of the synagogue that he built in Capernaum, to kind of vouch for him, right? Because really, as though Capernaum had was a city that was mixed with Gentiles and Jews, Jews didn't like to deal with Gentiles. So the best way to do this is a Gentile say, I'm going to send a Jew. I'm going to send a Jew over to talk to another Jew, and hopefully we'll have some kind of help here. And there's these words to Jesus are in hope that Jesus would listen to the message of these emissaries, these messengers, and say, you know what? You know what? You're right. He is worthy. Let me go to his house and go talk to him. He's done a lot for the city. The least that I can do is come and heal his servant, right? That's the hope that this centurion is having. Look at all the things that he's done. He's built us a beautiful synagogue. That should bring points right to Jesus, right? Oh, he's built this wonderful thing. That's one point. He doesn't rule over us, but you know what? He actually contributes to our society. And Jesus is thinking, you know, that's really good. I'll give him 2 points for that. He's got 3. He's on a good track. Their hope is that Jesus would find him worthy. But friends, in application to this, isn't that so often how we view our own Christian walk? I gotta make points. I gotta do the right thing in order for Jesus to accept me today. If I trip up, Jesus isn't gonna be happy, and I'm gonna lose some sort of standing with him because I didn't get enough points today. A series of points added or subtracted to somehow win the affection and attention of Jesus. If only I could have the attention of Jesus today, I know what I'll do. You know, I'll go tithe. I'll come to church. I'll worship the Lord, and then maybe he'll listen to me. Hey, I prayed for this man. Well, that's 1 point, 1 step forward, but I lied today. That's 3 steps back. I read my Bible today. That's 2 points. I gossiped. -4 points. I mean, friends, could we ever make it? Could we ever rise to that standard that we have in our own fallible minds that say that I'm accepted by Jesus Christ? Rather, what our true reality, the truth that screams in our own hearts, is the humble declaration, oh Lord, my iniquity separates me from you. You have to come to me. I can't come to you. As the psalmist declares in chapter 130, I love this. This has been just on my heart in the last 2 weeks. If you, O Lord, should count iniquities, Lord, who could stand? Who could make it? But with you there is forgiveness that you should be feared. Lord, I don't fear you because I'm afraid. I fear you because you have done what I could not do. Your affection for me is not based upon my own personal worth because I'm worthless. The Father's affection for me is because Christ lives in me and has given me all things that pertains to life and godliness. And I have the capability of doing things that are unnatural, that are not natural, that the world doesn't understand, because the love that was first shown to me as not just a servant, but as an enemy before God. Reading Psalm 130, I don't know if it is for you, but for me, that is just a pride killer. Isn't it? It's an arrogance killer. It gives me a sense of my own unworthiness. And I want to tell you something, friends, that might seem unnatural to you, but you know what? A sense of our own unworthiness, that's a healthy thing. That's a healthy thing. To actually think, you know what? I don't have it all going on. I don't have all that I need. That I actually need a Savior to save me, I actually need the righteousness of God to heal me, because I cannot fill that hole in my own heart that I try to satisfy with all the things the world, the flesh, and the devil tries to entice me to fill it. Only Christ. But you know what? Even in this man's desire to say, hey, Jesus, I'm worthy, I'm worthy, I'm worthy. What does verse 6 say? I love those five words. Jesus went with them. He knows the heart of this man before he's even met him. He knows the sincerity of this man before he even met him. And he's pursuing this man even when this man doesn't know it. Verse 6, and Jesus went with him. And when he was not far from the house, the centurion, he sends friends now. There's no need. I can't send larger emissaries with more authority. I gotta send men of my own heart, so I'm sending my friends. And they come and they meet Jesus before he even comes to the house. And he says to him, Lord, you know what? Please do not trouble yourself, for I'm not worthy to have you come under my roof. Something's changed in between those two messengers. The Holy Spirit is working. And Jesus goes with them. Even when the heart isn't right, when we find ourselves worthy, Jesus is still merciful to come. And so when the centurion, I would assume these emissaries go back to the house and they say, you know what? He's actually coming. I would kind of assume the centurion is like, he is? He's actually coming? One of an arrogant heart would assume, well, of course he's coming. Look at all I've done, right? If he wants gold filigree on the synagogue next year, he better come. But of course he's coming. Rather, there's a humility shown on behalf of the centurion. He says, you go back, my friends, can you go relate a message to him? Just have him stop. He can't come into a Gentile house. He's Jewish. He can't come under my roof. I understand the customs, but don't just tell him, don't trouble yourself because I am unworthy. And friends, isn't that the opposite end of the coin of our walk in the Christian path? Those occasions when we say, I am worthy, I am worthy, I am worthy, and I don't count the magnitude of my iniquities. And then there's the whole other end of the spectrum. We say, Lord, why do you even trouble yourself with me? I can't do it. There's no reason for you to pursue me, God, because I'm just not worth it. I'm not worth it. I mean, can we break down his statement for a second? Because he actually calls Jesus Lord here. I see this in the narratives, okay? When a man starts calling Jesus Lord, there's a change in the heart. Because that means Kyrios in the Greek. That means more than just, hey, smart guy. Hey, that means ruler over me. Here's a centurion, one of 60 over 6,000 men, and he says, Lord, ruler over me, don't trouble yourself. I'm not worthy for you to come under my household. Doesn't that arise and give effect to the process of this man's heart as he hears Jesus is coming to him? James Edwards, a wonderful biblical scholar, he says this about this occasion. He says, there's this dawning awareness. I mean, what a visual picture. There's a dawning awareness, a sunrise awareness that the Jesus who draws near to him is more than he imagined when he summoned him in the first place. Haven't we been there? When we experience humility that we express to Jesus, but a humility that comes to despair. Oh Lord, don't trouble yourself with me. I'm not worth troubling over anymore. I've sinned again, I've sinned again, I've sinned again. I hate my sin. I hate that it's a habit. I hate that it's an addiction in my own life. Why would you trouble yourself with me again, Lord? Christ proclaims in that moment, child, I will take every trouble and put it on my own shoulders because I've taken it to the cross. Not because you're worthy, but it's because I'm worthy. And I highly value you. I value you more than you could ever understand your value. I value you because you're firstly created in my image. And if you're created in my image, then that means you have purpose, you have value, and you have a reason to respond to my great love. I will take every trouble and I will put it on the cross for you. The centurion continues. He says, I didn't presume to come to you. I wouldn't even presume to come to you. But say the word. There's an emphasis. Say the word and let my servant be healed. For I too am a man set under authority, with soldiers under me. And I say to one, go, and he goes. And to another, come, and he comes. And to my servant, do this, and he does it. And he's almost, in a way, saying, Jesus, isn't this how you do things? Right? I mean, that's your authority, right? In a way, it's kind of like, you know, authority recognizes authority, But I understand a greater authority because I know how to lead men, but I also know how to submit under leadership. And I'm submitting under you, Jesus. If you just say the word, I know it's going to happen. Here we see why the centurion calls Jesus Lord. It's because of his faith. His faith specifically in the power of Christ to heal. Friends, the centrality of our Christian walk is a relationship of faith and humility. The centrality of our Christian walk, of your path, your journey under Christ, is a daily walk of faith and humility. In every situation, great or small, because this is the relationship. You know what? Humility declares, I'm incapable, God. Every single day, humility declares, I'm incapable. But my faith declares, you are capable. And you are more than capable to not only provide everything that I need, but also set my steps. No matter if I'm a pauper or if I'm a prince, you lead my steps in the way that I should go. You lead me beside green pastures, cool waters. You will restore my soul. Even when I sit at the table of my enemies, you are my portion. You're all that I need. You know, too often we equate faith to kind of be some weird amalgamation of like confidence and self-esteem. You know, that's why we hear so many prosperity gospel preachers mix it up. They take these kind of modern leadership tactics, you know, envision your goal, you know, that's their faith. And they switch confidence with faith, but rather that's not faith at all. Faith really isn't much of anything if humility is not with it. Because if you think you're capable, that's no faith at all. It demands an incapability. Be able to say, I have faith that Christ is capable. Spurgeon, you know, he says it better than I can. He says, your faith will not murder your humility. Your humility will not stab at your faith, but the two go hand in hand. And they go hand in hand in heaven like a brave brother and a fair sister. There's one that's bold as a lion and the other meek as a dove. The one rejoicing in Jesus and the other blushing at self. I love that. And this is the centurion. The centurion's faith wasn't based on Jesus' physical presence. It was rather based on Jesus' authoritative word. He trusted that Christ's order over the physical nature of his servant is enough to heal him. I don't have to be in your presence, Jesus, because I'm unworthy. But your word to me is enough. I love that concerning this man. Up until this point, friends, in all of the narratives and the encounters and relationships that Jesus has had with followers or with religious leaders or people that question who he is, what do the people ask of him first? Show us a sign, Jesus. Do something. Because that's going to show to me that you are who you say you are, right? Show us a sign. Perform a miracle. Prove yourself. Friends, true faith does not need a sign. True faith believes in the promise and rejoices when it sees the result. So much of our Christian walk, this is something that's burdened my heart recently, is encountering Christians who walk in a lifestyle of pursuing always some emotional experience. Some emotional experience. Friends, emotional experiences, they are not bad. They are important in the testimony of the life of the believer. They can even be these crisis moments that moves us towards sanctification. But it burdens my heart to hear so often of people who cannot progress in their spiritual walk because they're so obsessed with a season in their life when they had this emotional experience that instead of pursuing Christ, they're pursuing a feeling. They're oblivious to what Christ wants to do to their life now because they're so thinking about, oh, that summer in 1998 when it was just so restful in Christ. You know, I was talking to some guys, not in our church, talking to some guys about a conference that they were going to go to, and they were so excited, and it was exciting for me to feel their excitement, but this one guy was just, he couldn't get out of his head. I'm so looking forward to a Holy Spirit experience. I'm so looking forward to a Holy Spirit experience. That's what I want. Friend, you know, that's important. But what about a foundational stability of faith in His Word? What about a quiet peace that brings resolution and that is tangible for you to hold on to? What about a serenity that brings wisdom? Why does it have to be a physical, emotional experience? When the Word is enough to proclaim, this is all you need. I want to read the Word and then respond with emotional experience, right? Rather than say, I want this emotional experience totally outside of the wisdom of Christ Jesus. An unwavering faith in the Word from the breath of Christ is what lasts. Because when trials come, when suffering comes, when a loved one is dying on their deathbed, I'm telling you to just share with them, here's an emotional experience I had 6 years ago. It's not going to cut it. What cuts it is being able to say, this is what God promises, and my faith believes it. Hannah and I, we you know, don't need to get into it, but we went through a season of suffering, pretty hard sorrow a few weeks ago. And if it wasn't for the stability of God's Word in our life, we would have been helpless. If we didn't know the truth about God, if we could not vocally speak out and say these things, even when we felt tossed and turned by the waves of sorrow and suffering, if we could not say, we believe the Word in that it says, as for the Lord, His ways are perfect, and His orchestrations are supreme, and He will get us through this. If we didn't have that, if all we had was just to relate to this emotional experience, we'd be lost. We'd question the validity of God in our life if we did not have faith. And we were able to say, like Spurgeon says, I have learned to kiss the rock, or I've learned to kiss the wave that crashes me against the rock of ages. I've learned to kiss the wave that crashes me upon the rock of ages. This man's faith has been a testimony throughout 2,000 years. John Bunyan, the Puritan who was the writer of Pilgrim's Progress, said that this faith became the first Gentile conversion in Luke's gospel. Because one man trusted in Christ's authority to perform. Because he believed that a word from Jesus, Christ's word, would do to the disordered world of sickness and death what a word from a Roman officer does in a disordered disordered and rebellious society. He says, Jesus, just say the word. Just say the word. That's all I want. Say the word, Jesus. That's all I need. And sometimes that's all we can say when we're in suffering and when we're in sorrow. Sometimes it's the only thing we can say is, Jesus, you got to speak. Speak to me, Lord. Speak to me in your word. Speak to me in the close confidence of my heart. Speak to me in the silence that is deafening. Speak to me. And he always, always speaks. Coming to our conclusion, verse 9 and 10, let's see Jesus' response to this man. What a joyful response, verse 9 and 10. When Jesus heard these things, he marveled. He marveled at him. And turning to the crowd that followed him, he said, I tell you, friends, not even in Israel before have I found such faith. And when those who had been sent return to the house, they find the servant well. Isn't that just the icing on the cake? Jesus marveled at him. You know that word marveled? In the majority of Luke's gospel, every time that word is used, it's in the usage of people being marveled at Jesus. So this is extremely rare that Jesus marvels at the simple faith of a Gentile. A Gentile Roman military officer. It was the confirmation of this man's faith and conversion. And really, that isn't that the greater miracle in this story than the healing? Really? That's the greater miracle than even the healing of his own servant. Faith was found in an unexpected place. And it still comes from Jesus. This miracle is not simply that Jesus healed a servant at a spatial distance, but rather he spanned even a greater divide. It says, as Messiah, I'm not any respecter of persons. I've come for the Jew, then the Gentile. And here's a man who's faithful. And I'm going to respond to that faith. And I'm going to marvel at it. We brought a dirty Gentile, unclean, based upon every rabbinical law, bringing him to a great faith in Christ. And I personally, I look forward to standing in eternity with Jesus Christ and meeting a Gentile military Roman officer who had a simple faith to see that his servant was healed. Friends, are we aware, are we sensitive to understanding faith in the daily walk of our lives? Because, friends, it's not just flippant. It's not just excusable. It's not just an addition to your walk. Your faith means everything. It is the linchpin upon which you can trust in Jesus. Your love for Christ, your love for Christ is extended when you have faith to believe that he is constantly, enduringly, steadfastly working in you for his good pleasure. That when you're guilty and when you're ashamed of your sin, it's by faith we know that we are assured of our salvation, not by our works. And because of that, we cannot boast. We cannot have arrogance. We cannot have pride. But we can have humility, and friends, that is so much more powerful than any tactic of leadership that this world can offer. That's the desire of my heart. That's the desire, I hope, of your heart. As we close in prayer, let's close our eyes. If you've been convicted or exhorted in this understanding of scripture here in Luke 7, and you desire, Lord, you know, I have faith, but extend my faith. Lord, I believe, but Lord, help my unbelief. Give me boldness. Give me those things that I need. Lord, all of these things under heaven are mine. and the equipping of your saints for the good work and ministry of Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus, I just pray for these people. I pray, Lord, for their desire to seek you, Lord. I thank you, Lord, that even now, in their eyes being closed, in the inner thoughts of their heart and mind, they're being honest with you and saying that I just don't have enough faith to see this day end into tomorrow. I don't have enough faith to see this week go by. Lord, would you produce in me, Lord, produce in us a faith that is unwavering. A faith that is built not on the sand, but is built on the cornerstone of Jesus Christ. That is not built on my own self-esteem. That is not built on my own personal fleshly confidence, but faith that is built upon you. And in order for that to happen, Lord, I need humility. Humility so unnatural to my flesh, but Lord, I need humility. I believe and I know that I'm incapable, but Lord, by faith, I know you're capable. I know you're capable to save. I know you're capable to work. I know you're capable to provide and stand in the gap for me. Thank you, Lord, that you've produced in us good things by showing us your word. Thank you, Lord, that we have your very voice to speak to us in these pages. And I thank you, Lord, that by that, Lord Jesus, by the leaning upon the sufficiency of your word, we can look at the future with all of its obstacles, all of its sorrows, all of its potential sufferings, and say, I am equipped. I am equipped for these things. Because I know your word, and I know you. Because you will never leave me. You will never forsake me. Because you have never forsaken the righteous or left your children begging for bread. We thank you, God, for tonight. We thank you for your word. We pray, Lord Jesus, that it would be rooted into the soil of our hearts. Don't let us walk away and simply forget these truths. But Lord, set a standard for our life so that we might live better. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.